But I should first say that I think that right now, probably the best criteria you have when you want to find an antibody to a new target is to go in and look for what other people have been using. I mean, I think that's a no-brainer. If you have 500 antibodies out there, and some of them have been used by many others, it's probably the antibody you want to try first. I think that's easy to understand. What I want to talk about is a little bit about the pitfalls of this system, and I think that the antibody market really is problematic, because the antibody market is very inefficient. The antibody market does not effectively select the best products, and I will try to explain why. This is from the Santa Cruz catalog. On the right, left you see, and these are antibodies to CDK2, which is a widely studied protein.
Sorry,
it's better for you. Do I need to use this? Okay. I can use that. Will there be feedback? No. Okay. CDK2 is a very widely studied protein. And if you look at the citations on the right, you see that some antibodies have far more citation than others. And if I would go into this catalog and pick an antibody, of course I would pick the one with 687 citations. And of course that's what people have been doing for a long time. So, but the one down would not have much chance, right? So if we move on, does that mean, so what, I've launched something on, we had a little discussion on LinkedIn, and I launched something I call antibody impact factor. You know the impact factor of papers, but antibodies also now get an impact factor. So when an antibody first is used in a publication, it will be used by others and others and others, because this is a self, you know, this is a self-promoting process. And as soon as you have reached a certain number of citations, you almost have a patent on this antibody, because why would I not buy that antibody? So what I we're going to talk about is that this is not, this is good for some of you. It's good for those of you who have had the largest pie of this share already. This is where it's very difficult to come out with a CDK2 antibody that will beat Santa Cruz's top polyclonal. Well, why would I buy that? So how many antibodies to CDK2 are there? Well, according to this list, there are like 1,000. Maybe there's really only 100. But still, it's a very large number of antibodies. Does that mean that this antibody really is the best one? No, what it means is that the others haven't really been tested. We don't know if it's the best one. We know that it works, because it's been used in so many publications. It works, but it's not necessarily the best one. So what can we do to change this? I say that currently, the antibody market is survival of the first. If you get a good antibody, useful, not necessarily good, but if you get a useful antibody out there, and it gets a certain number of citations, you win. It doesn't help you if you are down on that list, number 100, and your antibody is better. Nobody will ever know. So of course what we want is we want survival of the finest. Now this animation sometimes is not exactly what you want. Okay, so we want to find those within that big forest, the trees that have really the best apples, the best fruit. But how are we going to do it? We've just learned now that antibody validation can be very expensive. So if you have a very good antibody to CDK2, first of all, you don't know that it's better than the market leader, because you haven't tried the market leader, and nobody else is going to do it for you. Nobody's going to write a review about this antibody, because nobody's going to buy it. So I would say that the data, the market data that we have, really suggests that most of the antibodies are just sitting in the fridges. They're not used, and they will never be tested, because testing is so expensive, and your customers are not going to do it, because they won't buy it. So we have a very large number of potentially very useful antibodies sitting around in fridges that don't have a chance in the market. And the way the market works today, this is not going to change, because validation is so expensive. So I think that if we think, we have to think new of how to, if we are going to change this, we have to think radically new. And I would say that one thing we could do is we could use arrays. Probably all of you have at some point heard about antibody array technology, and we all know it doesn't really work. It was first described from the Stanford people who made the DNA microarrays 14 years ago. Some companies tried to manufacture them, and Becton Dickinson, where I worked for a little while, was one of them. They bought Clontech, and Clontech sold an antibody array with 500 antibodies or something on it. It works like a DNA microarray. You label your proteins, put the solution onto your slide, and scan your slide. Well, the array was pretty expensive, of course. It was expensive to make, and it didn't really take off. BD sold it. Clontech is probably still selling this thing, but it's not really making much money. And why not? Well, the problem with antibody arrays is that you have an immobilized antibody. It's a single binder, and what you're measuring is how much protein does this antibody bind. That's what you're measuring. You have a native cell lysate, and a native cell lysate contains protein, protein complexes, aggregates, everything you can think of. You label the proteins, you put it onto the array, and you expect and hope that the signal you measure is from the intended target of the antibody. But of course, anybody who's done immunoprecipitation knows that you also have protein complexes and you've got cross-reactivity. And when you have 500 antibodies on an array and you want to measure the signals from all of these, which ones are real and which ones aren't? To validate this product is a nightmare. It's very, very difficult, and this is why it's never taken off. People simply don't trust it. You can do this with DNA because you can rely on the hybridization to be specific enough under certain conditions that you know that the DNA that binds to this spot is the DNA you want to measure. With antibodies, forget it. Can't do it. So how can we solve this? Well, the solution is, of course, to implement the same type of assays that you use for antibodies. We are all using single antibody assays, and one of them is the Western blot. Now, think that you could separate your proteins and elute them out of the gel, and rather than looking at all the proteins with one array, you would do one array for each little slice here. Well, then you are doing the same thing as you're doing in a Western blot. The only difference is you're using 1,000 antibodies at the same time, but you are resolving their binding against protein size. So you can make an assay like that. It's an antibody array Western blot. The problem is, of course, that if an antibody array costs you 1,000 euros, a Western blot is going to be 10,000 euros, and that's not going to be a big seller. So in order to do that, you need to make cheap chips. You need to make cheap microarrays that are so cheap that we can afford to separate proteins and use multiple arrays per sample. I think that's the only solution that I can think of that will really make antibody array analysis with protein labeling feasible. You need to separate your proteins so that the cross-reactivity, the protein complexes, and your intended target can be resolved like bands on a Western blot. If you can do that, there's no reason why you cannot use 1,000 antibodies simultaneously. You get exactly the same information as if you use them one at a time. So what we have done is that we have made a different type of arrays. They're not slides, they're beads. Probably many of you know what Luminex beads is. Luminex beads are good, but they are also pretty, even those are pretty expensive if you want to do this type of experiment. So we made our own. We have beads that we have colored ourselves, and at the moment we can make more than 1,728 different color codes. In fact, we can make 5,000. So we can have 5,000 differently colored beads, each with a different antibody on, and you can have three sizes. So if you happen to have 15,000 antibodies in lab, you can in fact use them all simultaneously. These beads are analyzed with flow cytometry, and a nice thing about bead-based arrays is you can use them in microwell plates. So rather than having slides on your bench, having 100 slides is not so easy to work with. But a 384 well plate is pretty simple to handle, especially if you have a liquid handling device. So what we do is we make arrays with beads with different antibodies on. Each antibody corresponds to a color code. So each bead has an individual color code corresponding to a specific antibody. You mix all the bits together, and you're doing, in this case, 1,700 immunoprecipitations simultaneously. I'll show you how it works. So here is the setup. It's a color-coded microsphere with an immobilized antibody. We biotinylate the sample proteins, and we detect them with streptavidin phycoerythrin. So we run the mixtures of thousands of beads with different antibodies and different proteins binding to them in the flow cytometer. The flow cytometer reads the fluorescent barcodes on the particles, and it measures the amount of streptavidin, which tells you how much protein, sample protein, this particular antibody bound. And now you need to separate them up front. So we have different separation systems. And these are just plain old-fashioned way to separate proteins. One we use is subcellular fractionation. So typically now we take 4 to 5 subcellular fractions. We label all the proteins in the fractions with biotin. And now we separate them by size using a size exclusion chromatography column. And if you do this, you end up with 96 fractions. So you have a 96-well plate with fractionated proteins. They're separated according to where in the cell they are and how big they are. You separate native proteins and protein complexes, and this gives you a tremendous resolution of your proteins. So now you have to put your beads, your bead array, into all the 96 wells of that plate. And of course, that's 100 arrays. If they cost €1,000 a piece, it would be very expensive. But since we are making them ourselves, it costs, you know, $10 to do this. Apart from the antibodies, of course, it costs a little bit more. But you don't need much antibody to make an array. So now we treat this in microwell plates. The antibodies will capture their target proteins from the fractions, and we label them with streptavidin PE and run them in a flow cytometer. So what do the data look like? They look like this. Now, the blue line here, these lines are chromatography lines, and it's a logarithmic plot, so it's probably a little bit unused. You're probably not completely used to seeing this, but size exclusion chromatography is used to look at protein complexes. It's been used a lot for that. And usually the readout is a Western blot, where you're looking at bands. Now, in this case, you're actually looking at the elution profile of the antibody targets. So each antibody captures something from the fraction, and you're simply looking at how much protein this particular antibody capture from this fraction. So how do we know if it's the right protein? Well, we know something about the subcellular distribution of proteins. We also know something about protein size. The elution point for a monomeric protein can, to a certain extent, be predicted in size exclusion chromatography. Protein complexes cannot. So in many cases, we see more than one peak, and the profiles can be very complex. So in order to know what we should be looking at, we run the same fractions by mass spectrometry. So we have mass spectrometry data for the proteins we're looking at. We have mass spectrometry data for 7,000 proteins, how they elute in the fractions. So we have kind of a control within the data so that we can overlay our antibody data on the mass spectrometry profiles. And so we know now which peak is real and which one is not. And I can show you an example. So in this case, for example, it's check one. It's a nuclear protein. The yellow here is a nuclear fraction. And you see this here. This is the mass spectrometry profile taken from a whole cell lysate. But you can see that the peaks match up very nicely. Here's another antibody to check one. We see the same peak here, but it's got an extra peak out here in the void volume, which is not real because there is no check two here. CDK2 is a protein that interacts with cyclins. It can also appear as a monomer. The monomer is here, and you can see the mass spectrometry peak right here. The complex here with the cyclins is eluting a little earlier, and it's more in the nucleus than in the cytosol. So what we do is that we compare different antibodies. Now, the beauty of working with antibody arrays is that now you don't have to validate each antibody at a time. You can work with thousands. You can work with 5,000 antibodies simultaneously, and that gives you a completely new perspective on things. When you are working with Western blotting, you're trying to optimize that particular Western blot so that your antibodies look as good as possible. And I think that this is one of the reasons why we have all these troubles with antibodies in the literature. Everybody's doing their best. Everybody is taking the role of the antibody company. They're trying to make this antibody shine. Of course, because you want your figures to look as good as possible. So if you go and look at people's Western blots, they have done everything they can to make your antibody look as good as possible. In this case, all the antibodies are used under exactly the same conditions. There is no optimization for each antibody because they're all on the same array. You're measuring all with the same instrument settings. They're all compared head to head. There is no way you can optimize each, you know, conditions for each bead. Of course you don't do that. So you're looking at capture in this case. This is multiplexed immunoprecipitation. And you're measuring not only with what people do is they do IP Western blotting. Well, of course, you only see your IP with a specific antibody and you Western blot with perhaps a different one, and it's like an ELISA. You see your target, but you don't see all the cross-reactivity. In this case, you're looking at all the proteins that are bound by this antibody because you're looking at capture of labeled proteins. So if the antibody is non-specific, such as this, just check one antibody here, bind something else, you see that. If you did IP Western, you wouldn't see that. So now you know, but then you get interesting results. You see that this antibody here, okay, it definitely has the highest peak for its target, much higher than this one, but it's got this extra reactivity. So what do you prefer? I mean, I would prefer this one. Probably not for immunohistochemistry, because I would be worried about this. But the thing is that you need to have some control within your assay system so that you can discriminate cross-reactivity from the real binding. And I think that if you would go only for antibodies that are absolutely 100% monospecific, you're not going to have many left. And they're definitely not going to be monospecific in all the assays you're going to use. You have to design your assays to deal with cross-reactivity, because cross-reactivity is there. This is a monoclonal antibody. We don't find that monoclonal antibodies are much less cross-reactive than affinity-purified polyclonals. There is cross-reactivity everywhere. It's sample-dependent. We have many antibodies that are affinity-purified polyclonals, even some that are not affinity-purified, that are just as specific as monoclonals. If you just separate your proteins enough, either it's on a microscope slide or it is in this case as with protein separation, this antibody here is extremely useful. It's the highest affinity probably check one antibody there is. So then this is another case where we actually use SDS page to separate proteins. We use in solution SDS page, but it's still SDS page, exactly the same thing. And I can show you quickly what that data looks like. So in this case, we have sorted the antibodies this way according to the size of the target. So CDKN2A is a small protein of 17 kilodaltons. CDKN1 is a little bit bigger. RelA is the biggest one. Now these are the fractions we get out. And in this case, up is bigger. So a small protein such as CDKN1A has its peak signal in fraction 3, 2A, 1A a little higher, etc., etc. And if you make a heat map out of this, it looks just like a Western blot. You know, the bands on the Western blot go up as the protein size go up. So this is like a digital virtual Western blot. It's just that you can do it with many antibodies at the same time. Western blot, and you sort your antibodies according to the size of the target. This is what you would expect to see. You would expect to see a ladder so that the bands go up as the intended target of the antibody increases. So now you have a digital Western blot with from an 8% jab with 430 antibodies. It could have been 4,000. And of course, it's a lot cheaper and faster to do a Western blot with 4,000 antibodies at once than to do them one at a time. That makes sense. And again, we measure the same fractions by mass spectrometry, so we know where the band should be. In many cases, you will see a band, and then there will be an explanation. Why is not the band where you would expect it to be? And there will be some sort of explanation. The truth is, of course, that in most cases, you don't know, because you don't really know if that band is your protein. If you go into the protein atlas, there will be suggested sizes for the protein that will vary from 10 kilodaltons up to 80, and there will be 5 bands, and they will say that, well, maybe all of them are isoforms. Well, who knows until you measured the fractions by MS and shown that those isoforms are actually there. So now you have reference data so that you know what you should find, you know where your band should be. Finally, we're making protein arrays. we immobilize in vitro expressed proteins or cellular expressed proteins onto beads. So in this case, the bead has anti-GST. We use in vitro expression, cell-free systems, as well as cellular expression. And we have cDNA clones from Josh LeBaire's group at the University of Arizona. So we are currently expressing 5,000 proteins, and he has promised us another 5,000 full-length cDNAs by mid-2015. In this case, your protein is on the bead. Now it went off, okay. So this is GST, this is your recombinant protein, this is your test antibody, and this is anti-mouse or rabbit with PE. These are dots each. Dot is a bead. In this case, there's a bead population out here showing the intended targets, and you have, you know, some extra populations that is cross-reactivity. In this case, you can now finally find out what exactly does your antibody react with. We don't know yet how useful these arrays are going to be. Origin made an array, you may have heard of it. They made a slide-based array with cell lysates from some 16,000 cell lines, where each one was overexpressing a different protein. And they made some ultramabs that are monospecific, and it's if you go on their website, they have found some that are very specific, and I think that some of them are supposed to be good for immunohistochemistry. So, coming back to the start, I asked you what antibody you would use to CDK2, which one you would buy. Now, this is the market leader. It's got 680 citations. This is the monomeric CDK2. This is the in the nucleus, in this case, it's a linear scale. There's a little bit of it in the nucleus too. Very nice profile, very nice antibody. Why would I ever want another one? Because I bought this one and it works. So let's look at the one with one citation. Well, that looks just the same, doesn't it? Because it's linear scale, and I've adjusted the scale like I would do in a Western blot. I would develop the Western blot so that it would look, you know, as good as possible. But now, let's look at them side by side with the same scale, and they look like this. So this is what you don't do, what you do when you do a Western blot. You buy an antibody, and you expose your Western blot, you titrate your antibody to make your band look as good as possible. When you achieve that, and it's relatively simple, you stop. Why would I look for a better antibody? It works. But if you had them done them side by side, using exactly the same concentration of antibody, exactly the same exposure, then you would have seen this. Well, this antibody is 10 times better. It's got one citation. No one will buy it. Nobody will ever know. And this is the problem with the antibody market today. There are probably many, many antibodies out there, and I'll just show you a few examples. This is what we find when we test many different antibodies to the same protein. If we test more than 5, 6, 7 antibodies, we find one that beats the current market leader easily. It's just that the world will never know, because it's too expensive to do it. So I think that what we have to do is that we have to get in all these antibodies, test them head to head in assays that people can rely on. So what we need to do is that we need to get a new algorithm for antibody validation. We need to test the antibodies against market leader in antibody arrays and protein arrays. We can do this at $50 per antibody, not 1,000. And those that come out, now you can go in and put your money into those. Because you cannot put in $1,000 to the 500,000 antibodies that are on the market. Nobody can do that. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, 90% of them are not good. We did a test with a OEM company, and they were shocked when we said, go and get as many antibodies as you can to these 30 proteins, and we'll test them. And when we first came with the data, we found that 80% of them didn't work almost at all. And they didn't want to believe us. Actually, they were slightly pissed off. So then they did their own controls. And they realized that we were right. So we can, in fact, what we're doing now is that we're documenting that these array-based assays do indeed denature the immune precipitation. It's pretty much the same antibodies. So I think that was what I was going to say. So now this is like we do today. We fish for good antibodies. But what you really want to do is this, right? Oh, no, it's gone. Oh, there it is. What happened to you? I must show this slide. There. Where is it? Okay, anyway. So yeah, so this is what you want to do. If you want to catch fish, use new, modern, good equipment. And then you can really, you know, this is what you need to do in today's market. There's no use in taking one antibody at a time in today's antibody market. There are just too many reagents out there. Thank you.